What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Today, we kick off a new series on GraphQL. In this series, we'll explore the fundamentals of GraphQL, a powerful and flexible query language for APIs. We decided to dive into GraphQL because it offers a more efficient, powerful, and flexible alternative to traditional REST APIs, making it an essential tool for modern software development. So, what exactly is GraphQL? Well, GraphQL is a query language for our APIs and a runtime for executing those queries that uses a strongly typed system to define our data. It was developed by Facebook, released in 2015, and unlike REST, GraphQL allows clients to request exactly the data they need, making it more efficient and flexible. In this first video, we'll take a hands-on approach. We'll start by seeing GraphQL in action and then explore the theoretical aspects. If you encounter unfamiliar terms, don't worry, we'll cover them in the second part of this video or in future uploads. So, to see GraphQL in practice, we'll be making use of the Spring Boot project we wrote in our Spring Boot series. Feel free to create a brand new project with the help of Spring Initializer if you prefer. Okay, in that project, we'll keep everything as is. Add the dependency we see to our pom.xml file and create a new package named GraphQL. Here, we will create a new controller class. In this class, we will copy-paste the previous controller we wrote, and instead of using the @getMapping, @putMapping, and @postMapping annotations, we will use the @queryMapping and @mutationMapping annotations. Also, under our resources folder, we will create a schema.graphql file. In this file, we will redefine all the request and response objects used by the APIs we just copy-pasted. Additionally, we will define the endpoints themselves under the corresponding category. In the query section, we will put the get operations, and in the mutation section, we will put the post and put endpoints. Okay, the final change to our project is to add the Spring Boot configuration we see to the application.properties or YAML file. Now, run the application and navigate to localhost/graphiql. Here we will be able to query our Postgres database, insert videos, update them, and retrieve information related to a specific video. GraphQL allows us to request precise details. In this example, we requested specific information tied to the video with the title My First Video, and our API will fetch that information and that information only. Another thing we can do is bundle multiple APIs in a single call. In this example, we created and updated a video simultaneously with a single call to our server. Okay, let's take a look at one more advantage of GraphQL. To do that, we'll modify the author in our GraphQL schema from a string to a complex object. We will not modify the Java object responses and requests, just the schema. And of course, we will have to create their corresponding input and type objects in the schema file. Okay, real quick guys, if you're enjoying the content and want to help grow the channel, you can now become a member of the Geekific community. Members will get loyalty badges, private chat rooms, exclusive content, and much more. All you have to do is click the join button and choose how you'd like to be involved with us on this journey. Okay, so with the current state of our classes, GraphQL won't know how to map between the type written in its schema and the Java object, since in Java the author is a string and not a complex object. To fix this, we will create a new method in the controller annotated with @schemaMapping. This method takes in a video response and returns an author object. Assuming we have a repository from which we fetch authors, this method will help us map the author's name present in the response to the actual object it represents fetched from the database. Now, if we navigate back to the GraphQL endpoint, we can request the full video object or any specific attributes we want. And note that if we do not request the author's information, GraphQL will not fetch this information and will not reach out to the author's data access at all, optimizing our API's performance. Okay, now that we have seen what GraphQL is about and discussed the tip of what it is capable of, let's go over why should we be using GraphQL? Why are we going through the effort of duplicating our classes or types to make use of it? Well, first and most importantly, GraphQL is efficient. With GraphQL, clients can request only the data they need, reducing overfetching and underfetching issues, leading to improved performance. GraphQL is flexible. GraphQL provides more flexibility in how clients can query data. They can fetch multiple resources in a single request, reducing the number of network calls. GraphQL APIs are evolvable. They are more adaptable to changes as we can add new fields and types to the schema without impacting existing queries, allowing us to evolve our API more easily. The schema it makes use of is strongly typed. This type system in GraphQL ensures that both clients and servers agree on the shape of the data, leading to better documentation and tooling support like auto-completion and IDEs. Finally, GraphQL provides a better developer experience. You see tools like GraphiQL, the graphical interactive in-browser GraphQL IDE, allow developers to explore and interact easily with the API, improving productivity and understanding. Now, like all tools, GraphQL has common use cases in which it is widely used. You see, GraphQL's efficiency in data fetching makes it ideal for mobile and web applications. Its flexibility shines when clients need to aggregate data from multiple sources or make complex queries. Also, for teams iterating quickly on their APIs, GraphQL allows seamless changes without breaking existing clients. Additionally, GraphQL can serve as a unified API gateway in microservices and serviceless architectures, consolidating multiple services into a single API. Now, before ending this video, let's address the concern of duplication, which I'm sure many of you thought about. You see, while it might seem like GraphQL requires duplication of our Java classes in schema definitions, there are several ways to mitigate this. We can use libraries like GraphQL SPQR to replace our schema with annotations inside of our Java classes, avoiding the need for separate schema files. Or we can make use of schema generation tools to generate schema files from existing classes or vice versa, reducing manual duplication. So, to sum up, GraphQL offers a more efficient, flexible, and developer-friendly way to interact with APIs compared to traditional REST. While it may introduce some initial overhead in setting up the schema, the long-term benefits in terms of performance, flexibility, and maintainability often outweigh the initial costs. Let us know in the comments below if you'd like us to dive deeper and explore the many other aspects and functionalities offered by GraphQL. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.